Hi everyone, let's get started. Thanks for attending today's webinar on maximizing BioCord technology performance using process control method. This is the final webinar in our five-part BioCord webinar series that we have presented over the past few weeks. Last week, we explored how we design BioCord system using advanced modeling software. And today we will see how proper control and optimize BioCord process to achieve carbon and total nitrogen removal with the lowest energy and cost. If you missed any of our prior webinars, or if you would like to watch them again, visit the Bishop Water YouTube channel. You can find all of our webinars there and a lot more. Moreover, keep an eye on our Twitter and LinkedIn accounts for more webinars to come, as well as news and interesting case studies from Bishop Water Technologies. You can also go to our website and sign up for our monthly e-newsletter to receive that information. All the webinars in this BioCord series have been presented by my colleague, Christine Gunn, and by me, Roberta Maffettone. I'm the speaker of this last webinar. We are both wastewater and engineering specialists here at Bishop Water Technologies, and we can be contacted via email if you have any questions about the content of these webinars or about these topics in general. A few housekeeping items before we get started. First, we will be recording the webinar, so we ask that everyone please keep their microphones on mute. If you would like to ask a question, please use the chat function. You can access this by clicking on the chat icon in the top right corner of your screen and type your questions in the dialog box. For those that have joined by phone, you are welcome to email your questions to my email address. I won't address questions as they come in, but instead I will try to answer them at the end of the webinar. And if there happen to be more questions that I cannot answer during the session, I'll address them by email and send the responses to everyone registered. We'll also follow up with an email that has a link to the recorded webinar and some additional information about BioCord reactors. As usual, we first introduce our BioCord technology for those who might be joining us for the first time. BioCord is a modular fixed film energy efficiency technology designed by Bishop Water to achieve high carbon and total nitrogen removal all year around, even in cold conditions when many wastewater systems struggle to hit their nutrient reduction targets. For more information about different configuration of BioCord and cold weather application, I invite you to rewatch our webinar on a registered webinar that you can find on the YouTube channel. We can manufacture BioCord reactors in standard and customized configurations to enhance BOD, COD, solids, and nitrogen removals. BioCord is most commonly used in pre-assembled frames that are brought to site and installed directly into a lagoon or tank. This allows for the fastest and least disruptive installation process. The plant can remain in operation and the entire installation process can be completed in just a few days. We can also install BioCord in curtain show in the center photo or in a containerized system that you can see here on the right. BioCord can be used to retrofit existing lagoons or basins in municipal, agricultural, or industrial applications. BioCord that can increase plant capacity and allow for higher volumes of wastewater to be treated. And it can also be designed as a standalone system dedicated to treating the specific wastewater streams. To learn more about the process design that we use for our BioCord reactors, you can watch our webinar on design optimization that we have presented last week. And you can find that on the YouTube channel. Here's a quick example of a municipal plant upgrade that we are very proud of. This project uses BioCord reactors along with the other facility upgrades to enhance plant treatment and performance. Just a couple of weeks ago, at the Canadian Water Summit, Bishop Water received the 2020 Water's Next Award for this project in the category of Projects and Technology Early Adoption. The award is a very significant acknowledgement of the value that simple, low-energy BioCord technology offers for upgrading existing wastewater lagoon with enhanced ammonia removal. One of the biggest benefits of this project is that the National Municipality, which is a rapidly growing community near Ottawa, can alter its operation from intermittent discharge to continuous discharge. This will enable the community to extend the life of its existing lagoons and better service residential and commercial growth. And it can do that without the need to build a costly mechanical treatment plant, which provides significant savings in capital and long-term operating costs. So the BioCord reactors has three key components, the BioCord media, an aluminum frame to hold the media, and an integrated aeration system that enhances the formation of a robust biofilm. This aeration system, coupled with the energy-efficient compressors, provides high oxygen transfer capability to supply oxygen directly to the microbial community. It also acts as a mixing system that helps with scoring and formation of new biofilm and prevents the formation of an anaerobic environment. In this webinar, we will look at how we have optimized the aeration system to effectively transfer oxygen to the biofilm in order to consistently achieve high levels of organic carbon and ammonia removal. And moreover, we will illustrate how we can control the required amount of oxygen inside the BioCord reactor to achieve simultaneous nitrification and denitrification for total nitrogen removal. Let's see first how nitrification and denitrification happen inside a BioCord reactor. Inside the biofilm, both aerobic and anaerobic conditions coexist. Dissolved oxygen that is present in the bulk liquid should be at an adequate concentration so that the fraction can diffuse inside the biofilm and be available to the heterotrophic or nitrifiers bacteria, as you can see in this picture on the left. The nitrifier bacteria developed inside the biofilm will activate when the dissolved oxygen is instead present at lower levels in the bulk liquid. Therefore, if we can control the level of oxygen in the bulk liquid, we can achieve both nitrification and the denitrification in the BioCord biofilm. This process of converting ammonia to nitrate by using dissolved oxygen and then nitrate to nitrogen gas by using the molecular oxygen present in the nitrates, as shown in these figures, will result in total nitrogen removal. In nitrification and organic carbon removal processes, the dissolved oxygen in the bulk liquid represents the limiting factor. In fact, the heterotrophic bacteria can degrade organic substances by using the oxygen available in the system. Like a heterotroph, also nitrifiers require dissolved oxygen to complete their reactions. In the nitrification process, ammonia nitrifiers and nitrate oxidizing bacteria also use oxygen in a two-step process. Therefore, more oxygen than the heterotrophic is required, especially in cold weather conditions. When there is limited dissolved oxygen, the reaction won't happen, and therefore it's extremely important that an adequate concentration of oxygen is present in the bulk liquid and those transferred to the biofilm. Oxygen is typically supplied to biological processes by insufflating air in the system, for example, using a blower or a compressor. Oxygen transfer systems accounts for as much as 60% of the energy consumption in typical activated sludge processes. Therefore, it often represents the most costly part of the biological process. To ensure that we can provide an abundant oxygen supply for BioCord reactors without consuming a lot of energy, we develop an integrated fine bubble aeration system that runs on compressors rather than energy-intensive blowers. The aeration grid is at the bottom of the BioCord frame, just under the BioCord media, and this ensures that the fine bubbles dissolve in the bulk liquid and the oxygen is delivered directly to the biofilm. It also helps with mixing and provides a scoring effect to slow off excess dead biofilm and promote biofilm replenishment. This high-efficient BioCord aeration system was tested and optimized by conducting several projects. One of these was carried out at pilot scale in collaboration with Western University. This project aimed to compare two different types of aeration system installed in BioCord reactors, a coarse bubble system to which air was provided by a blower, and a fine bubble tubing system for which pressurized air was provided by a compressor. Tests were done with both the blower and compressor running at full maximum capacity to simulate field operations. The compressor's airflow rate was 50 liters per minute, and the blower was running at 90 liters per minute. The removal of BOD and COD was happening in a previous tank equipped with a compressor, so that only nitrification was performed in the two reactors that were object of the tests. The two systems were then compared for oxygen transfer efficiency and for their ability to remove ammonia. To determine oxygen transfer efficiency of an aeration system, we need to test specific parameters that measure the capacity of an air bubble to transfer its oxygen content to the biomass. In fact, a highly efficient aeration system ensures that oxygen is effectively transferred from the air bubble to the biofilm and then from the biofilm to the microbe or the bacterial cell to be utilized. This image shows how this process will happen in a few steps. The oxygen is present is in the gas phase inside the air bubble, has to first dissolve through the gas-liquid interface. It will be then present in the bulk liquid and needs to find its way at the interface from the liquid film to the biofilm, the liquid-solid interface, because it can be utilized by the cell. The size of an air bubble plays a role in effecting transfer of oxygen to the bacterial cell, among also other specific parameters of the of water. By reducing the size of the bubbles by keeping the same volume of air, we can get better performance with less energy and cost. So during our aeration project, we have measured several parameters to understand the capacity of the air bubble to transfer oxygen. Here there is a list of them. We involve those that required more attention when we compared the two aeration systems. So the KLA, which is the volumetric oxygen mass transfer coefficient, measured in kilogram of oxygen per hour, which describes how fast the oxygen present in the gas phase is transferred to the liquid medium by dissolution. It is usually measured in clean water, and it depends on mixing intensity, air flow rate, bubble size, residence time. The SOTR, the standard oxygen transfer rate, measured in kilogram of oxygen per hour, and represents the rate of oxygen transfer to the test liquid at standard condition per hour, and is a function of the KLA, of the oxygen saturation value in milligram liter, and of the volume of the basin. And then we the alpha value, which indicates the difference in aeration performance in clean water versus field condition, so in wastewater. It has the biggest impact on the SOTR in a treatment plant. So let's have a look at some of the results. In terms of ammonia removal, both of the BioCord reactors, the one equipped with coarse bubble and blower, and the other one with fine bubble and the compressor, achieve high ammonia removal at the various loading expressed as surface area loading rates here in this graph with the red line. The green line indicates the ammonia in the effluent for the reactor equipped with the blower, and in blue, the same for the reactor equipped with the compressor. So even though the compressor was supplying 45% less airflow than the blower, so we remember 50 liters per minute versus the 90 liters per minute of the blower, they were still available, to achieve the same or better ammonia removal because of the high efficiency of the fine bubbles to transfer more oxygen to the biofilm. In the long run, the low energy compressors will also provide significant savings in energy costs. The study did also look at how ammonia removal would be affected when the blower output was reduced to match the airflow of the compressor, so 50 liters per minute. Here, both the compressor and the blower, they were running at 50 liters per minute. And you can see in this box that when this happened, there was a reduction in efficiency by the blower. This was due to the less efficient oxygen delivery and transfer performed by the blower. So high ammonia removal in both the system was due to the high presence of dissolved oxygen inside both the reactors, as you can see in this graph, where dissolved oxygen concentration measured over time are reported with the red line for the reactor equipped with the blower, and in blue for the reactor equipped with the compressor. From this graph, we can see that the influent DO concentration remained consistently low, below 2 milligram liter for the majority of this project period, and both the systems were able to maintain high DO levels in the BioCord effluent. However, the same concentration of dissolved oxygen was provided by the fine bubble equipped with the compressor that was insufflating 45% less air than the blower. In this table, we show in details the difference between the coarse and fine bubble system by looking at the KLA, the volumetric oxygen mass transfer, and other parameters, the alpha value. The oxygen transfer for the coarse bubble in standard condition was higher than the one for the fine bubble, which is to be expected, given he has a higher air flow of 90 liters per minute. However, we can see that the ammonia removals were still higher with the fine bubble system on average. This is likely due to the fact that the fine bubble system has a much higher alpha value. Or system efficiency compared to the blowers. So as you can see, the fine bubbles operate at 90% system efficiency in wastewater compared to clean water, as indicated by the value of the alpha equal to 0.9. And in comparison, the oxygen delivery efficiency of the blower is much lower in wastewater conditions, allowing for only about 52% of the oxygen delivery at standard conditions. Let's see how these observations can be transferred to energy requirements and associated costs. Fine bubbles are formed by using bubble tubing diffusers connected to the compressor. As we have already seen, with this system, we can get more dissolved oxygen inside the BioCord reactor by using less air, thus less energy is required. This makes our compressors energy efficient. Typically, only one three-quarter horsepower compressor is needed to supply air to each BioCord reactor. In terms of CapEx and OpEx costs, as you can see in the graph here on the right, our bubble tubing system requires less capital and 20 years hydro cost than a competitor that was using blowers to achieve the same amount of airflow. As you can see from the area shaded in red in the graph, which shows the energy consumption, BioCord compressor will use far less energy than blowers over the 20 years period. And this translates to significant operational cost savings in addition to the improved performance when using this kind of bubble tubing with BioCord reactors. Moreover, we are able to opt for those more energy-efficient systems because our biofilm is fixed in place, unlike suspended system or even moving biofilm systems like MBBRs. We don't need to expand energy to maintain the movement of the biofilm or the biofilm carriers. We can just focus all the energy into getting oxygen in the biofilm. The fine bubbles are only released when the diffuser tubing also becomes pressurized. So clogging or buildup of sediments on the diffusers also isn't typically an issue, which helps keeps maintenance costs at minimum. The fine bubble being released also help our biofilm to self-regulate and self-clean. The mixing action of the fine bubbles aids in the sloughing off the excess biofilm, dead biomass or sediments, which allows the biofilm to be continuously replenished itself with the active and proliferating bacteria. In this way, the BioCord biofilm is self-perpetuating. It doesn't require any cleaning or special operational maintenance to sustain itself. We have just seen how enhanced oxygen delivery in BioCord reactors led to high carbon and ammonia removal. As we have anticipated previously, total nitrogen removal can also be achieved in BioCord biofilm by following the cycling process shown in the figures, where ammonia is first converted to nitrite and nitrate by using dissolved oxygen, and then nitrate can be converted to nitrogen gas. To do so, we have to reduce the dissolved oxygen in the BioCord reactor to low levels so that the nitrifier bacteria will activate and use the molecular oxygen present in the nitrate species for their metabolism. Since in the BioCord biofilm, both nitrifiers and the nitrifiers bacteria are developed, we can control the level of dissolved oxygen in the reactor to the concentration to induce the activity of each type of bacteria without inhibiting the growth of the other type. This can happen by simply controlling the aeration system to create alternate aerobic or anoxic environment by controlling on and off status of the aeration system in a single BioCord reactor, or using two separate tanks where one is completely aerated and the other one can operate in pre or post anoxic condition. To investigate the ability of BioCord to achieve total nitrogen removal, we conducted an in-house pilot project to test two different operational setups. In one setup, we tested how BioCord can operate in a single reactor to achieve simultaneous nitrification and denitrification. And in another setup, we tested how BioCord can operate using two separate reactors, one operating in pre-denitrification without aeration system, and the other in nitrification mode with a completely aerated BioCord system. The aim of the test was to investigate different operational conditions and to collect information that will help us to design a BioCord process that fit a specific application. For example, we wanted to investigate how the BioCord biofilm would perform in pre-anoxic condition in case we are looking into retrofitting an existing plant that is already operating in pre-denitrification and denitrification mode. And moreover, we wanted to collect more specific design parameters and operational changes so that the BioCord reactor system can be tailored to such specific treatment targets, for example, if we need to remove nitrates. So here are the two schemes that we investigated. The two systems operated at similar conditions of ammonia loads and hydraulic retention time. A synthetic wastewater containing ammonia and organic carbon was used for both the experiment. The presence of organics in the wastewater is a limiting factor in a denitrification process. Therefore, the system was kept at an appropriate carbon to nitrogen ratio. In the scheme presented on the left, the single BioCord reactor was equipped with our fine bubble tubing aeration system, and the compressor was switching on and off, alternatively controlled by a timer. The length of each phase was determined by dissolved oxygen measurements and adjust over time based on that analysis to achieve ammonia and nitrate removal. So therefore, different type of cycling were tested over time. And on the scheme on the right, one BioCord reactor was installed without the aeration system, and the other BioCord was kept completely aerated by using the bubble tubing and the compressor. Because in the aerated tank, the ammonia was converted to nitrate, a certain volume of wastewater was recirculated back to the anoxic reactor for the denitrification stage. And we chose to investigate a pre-anoxic and not a post-anoxic condition since we wanted to use the carbon source available in the synthetic wastewater. Also, the volume of the wastewater under aerobic and anaerobic conditions was kept at the same percentage for both the two systems, so that we were able to compare the two schemes under exactly the same condition, length of aerobic and anaerobic phase, ammonia and carbon loadings, and the hydraulic retention time. Here there are some of the results of the first configuration of the single BioCord reactor operating in simultaneous nitrification and denitrification. You can see the influent total nitrogen bars are those lighter on the left, whereas the effluent total nitrogen bars are here darker on the right, and the fractionation of the total nitrogen components are shown on the bottom legend. By experimenting with different aeration cycles and carbon to nitrogen ratios, we managed to achieve a 98% reduction in total nitrogen using just a single BioCord reactor. The best aeration cycle was determined to be with 30 minutes of the system kept completely aerated and 1 hour of aeration interrupted for to create anoxic conditions. We also perform microbiological analysis on the biofilm, and we confirmed that both nitrifiers and denitrifiers were present in the biofilm. Here we show the results of the BioCord reactors operating under pre-anoxic conditions. Again, the lighter bar on the left showed the fractionation of the total nitrogen in the influent, which were mainly composed by ammonia, and the colorful bar on the right shows the total nitrogen at the outlet. Also, with this configuration, we were able to achieve high total nitrogen, high percentage of total nitrogen removal. Samples of the biofilm collected from both the aerated and the anaerobic reactor showed that the denitrifiers were more present in the anoxic conditions as we expected. From an operational point of view, we were also able to easily operate the system by recirculating back the nitrate and maintaining an adequate level of carbon to nitrogen ratio around 9 to 10. So the results of this project help us to better understand the impact of aeration control and also of the carbon source that we use for the denitrification stage. This observation can be highlighted just by looking at this bar graph that shows the total nitrogen in the influent light bar and the effluent darker bars of the single BioCord reactor operating in nitrification-denitrification mode, but over several weeks of experiments. So the first block of the graph reports the result under an aeration cycle of 1 hour on and 1 hour off. And as you could see, this cycle did not result in achieving total nitrogen removal. The second block of the graph reports the results of the total nitrogen removal when the aeration cycle was set up to 30 minutes on and 1 hour off. Under these operational conditions, significant amount of total nitrogen removal was achieved since we could reach more easily anoxic conditions. However, some nitrate buildup was still observed, suggesting that this could be caused by the type of carbon source that we were using in the system. So we did some more experiment changing the carbon source. The results from this change are shown in this third block of results, where you could see that consistent amount of total nitrogen was removed from the system. This type of experiment suggested us that we could have reached optimal removal if our system was able to automatically adjust itself based, for example, on the measured value of dissolved oxygen, ammonia, and nitrate. So in fact, we can use specific sensors, data logger, and program logic control system to either check continuously the main important factors of our process or adjust them with automatic system. Online monitoring can be done by using off-the-shelf sensors and, for example, DO sensors, ammonia, nitrate sensor, pH, ORP, and temperature to continuously measure the performance of our system. This sensor can be easily installed, for example, at the outlet of a lagoon where BioCord reactors are installed to see if we are achieving our target removal. In some cases, as the one we have presented during this webinar, we might require more sophisticated process control in which the sensor will be connected to a programmable logic control a system to automatically adjust operational requirements. For example, in the case of total nitrogen removal, we would like the aeration to be controlled by the level of the dissolved oxygen or ammonia measured in the reactor. This type of system can be beneficial when we are using BioCord, for example, in decentralized or remote system to treat domestic wastewater or for small footprint industrial applications where ammonia and nitrate are contaminants of concern. Process control for BioCord can be designed based on the specific project requirements. We can identify the most appropriate sensors and develop the control logic in order to automatically adjust the system. But we want at the same time also to ensure simplicity in maintenance and operation of the process control system. So these are some of the benefits we could have achieve by using process control methods. First of all, we can optimize energy usage and cost savings by, for example, when the aeration system will adapt automatically to the contaminants loads or target removals. We can increase treatment efficiency since we are monitoring target contaminants and process key factor. We can extend the life of equipment since we operate them only when it is necessary, and this is especially important in aeration system. And with the process control system, we can reduce operator oversight since the system will automatically adjust, for example, during high variability, and the best conditions can be maintained without continuous monitoring. Online monitoring will also allow for easy visualization of real-time effluent quality data so that any problem in the system can be detected tempestively. So let's see a few examples of process control strategies that we are investigating in a BioCord system. One example, as we have already anticipated, is to control the aeration system to automatically adjust the dissolved oxygen levels inside one single BioCord reactor when it is operating in simultaneous nitrification and denitrification. To do so, we can use a DO sensor installed in the reactor. The DO sensor will measure the fluctuation of the oxygen. One example of fluctuation is reported in this graph, where you can see how DO is increasing over 51 minutes of continuous aeration and how it decreases when the aeration is interrupted, for example, in this case, during 9 minutes. If the DO sensor is connected to a system capable to read the measurement and send the signal to the compressor, then we can tell the compressor to turn on and off when specific DO levels set point are reached in the reactor. And this can be operated in just one sensor mode, but we can also include an ammonia and nitrogen sensor to the logic control. In this case, the aeration control will be based not only on the measured value of the DO, but also on the value of ammonia and nitrate, so that we can control also for how long the aeration should stay on and off until the specific set points level of ammonia and nitrates are achieved. Another parameter that plays an important role in nitrification denitrification process that can be easily measured by a sensor is pH. With the process control, we can also think to dose the amount of sodium bicarbonate to require to adjust the pH to the required level, especially when we are treating industrial wastewater. The benefits of controlling the pH can be seen in this graph on the left, that is from one of our experiments. The red line shows the pH measured in a BioCord reactor tank, and the blue line shows the ammonia removal in percentage in this reactor. At the beginning of the experiment, the pH was measured manually with a lab sensor. And the pH variation in the influent resulted in difficulties in achieving consistent ammonia removal. For this reason, an online pH sensor was installed and then connected to a dosing system that was constantly dosing sodium bicarbonate to increase the pH to level required for the nitrification process, as you can see here on the right. From the point indicated with the yellow line, when the pH controller was installed, then consistent values of pH higher than 7.5 were maintained. With this system in place, we were able to maintain more steady ammonia reduction, as we didn't have to worry about constantly manually dosing sodium bicarbonate. The few dips that you observe in ammonia reduction here are linked to the variations of other factors that were involved in the process, for example, the HRT and the ammonia concentration in the inlet. However, with the help of a pH controller, it's one less variable that we have to consider, as we have confidence that the pH and the alkalinity is maintained in a range that is conducive for nitrification. As we have seen previously, another aspect that influences total nitrogen removal is the presence of carbon in the system. The ratio of carbon to nitrogen represents one limiting factor for the metabolism of the nitrifier bacteria that need an organic source when they are reducing nitrates to nitrogen. This is a typical problem in domestic wastewater, in which high ammonia is present along with very low carbon concentration. So when the ammonia is converted to nitrate and no carbon is available in the wastewater, the denitrified bacteria will, the anoxic phase alone will not properly function. And in this case, we will need to dose an external amount of carbonaceous substance, for example, methanol or ethanol. To better control the carbon dosing, we can also think to use a nitrate sensor so that we could dose the required amount of carbon to maintain the carbon to nitrogen ratio. And this is an example of a BioCord system that we have designed for a project in which the wastewater had high ammonia level and low organic carbon, and the target effluent was in that case nitrate at a concentration lower than 10 milligram liter. For this case, a BioCord system can be designed in multi-steps following the scheme that you can see. A first tank without the BioCord media will serve as a settler tank to remove any suspended solids. Then a BioCord tank without aeration system will be used to create pre-anoxic conditions. The following two tanks will be needed for the conversion of ammonia to nitrate by completely aerated BioCord reactors. The nitrate then that will be formed during nitrification stage will be sent back to the pre-anoxic tank by recirculating an amount of the flow. And since no organic carbon is present in the influent, a carbon dosing system can be used to provide an external carbon source for the denitrifier's bacteria. This dosing pump can, as I said before, can be connected, for example, to a nitrate sensor so that the system can be automatically adjusted. In collaboration with Western University and the instrumentation team of Lambton College, we are working on developing a BioCord online process control system that could automatically control the BioCord process under different operational modes. In this slide, we just show the interface of our process control system since we have just finalized the coding phase and we are moving into the stage of installation and testing at our pilot. System will be connected to several sensors, pH, ORP, DO, ammonia, and nitrate, with the aim to remotely control our process without the need to go physically on site to check the performance, but only when maintenance is required. So we can observe any failures in the system by a continuous data analysis. And moreover, as we have just shown, some of the sensors will be connected to a program logic control to automate the aeration cycles. We aim to investigate different control mode strategies that can be selected from the user interface based on the required set points of oxygen level to achieve total nitrogen removal. So one of the strategies that we are investigating is the one that we just showed, and this is the simultaneous nitrification, denitrification. However, with this process control system, specifically designed for the BioCord reactor, we aim to explore more advanced processes for total nitrogen removal, such as nitrate shunt or partial deammonification. Those processes will benefit of continuous measurement of ammonia nitrates inside the reactor to set up the aeration. For example, in the nitrate shunt process, the sensor will measure the conversion of the ammonia to nitrate species so that the aeration can be interrupted at a specific set point. And the same for the deammonification process, the sensor together with the process control logic will control the aeration base, for example, when the ammonia is converted to 50% to nitrate. To this point, we have focused entirely on BioCord process control, but Bishop Water also offers solids management and chemical treatment system that can be integrated to create a complete solids and nutrient management solution. So I would like to talk a bit about how we use our process control experience to develop an integrated treatment solution. Let's start with the Bishop process control methods that are used in our solids management system with the geotube technologies. Since a geotube dewatering system is enhanced by coagulation flocculation, our pre-dosing system, the VPAS injection system shown in this picture, can automatically dose the required amount of polymer based on the measurement of the solids content by the help of the TSS probe or adjusting with the flow measured by a mag flowmeter. This process can be performed upfront a BioCord reactor, for example, when we need to reduce solids a level lower than 200 milligram liter in the treated wastewater. Bishop also has experience in integrating process control methods to treat atypical wastewaters like mine effluents or those contaminated with hazard materials such as heavy metals. In the case of heavy metals precipitation, a process control system can be designed to meet specific targets by precisely controlling pH and chemical dosing. In this way, we are able to open up BioCord to treat a variety of wastewaters by implementing an automated pretreatment system that can remove contaminants that would typically be detrimental to biological activity, for example, heavy metals or radionuclides. And here is one last example of an environmental remediation project for which we designed a water treatment system to eliminate heavy metals and arsenic radioactive elements using a series of automated chemical dosing processes. The goal of the system was to eliminate arsenic, cadmium, cobalt, mercury, molybdenum, and other heavy metals, and radium and uranium. This was done by a combination of chemical precipitations and flocculation prior to the geotube. Two pH sensors were used to control the process. First, the influent pH was raised to a set point of 10 to 11 by dosing lime. By raising the pH to a specific set point using a pH controller, heavy metals are able to be precipitated out as insoluble metal hydroxides. And after this reaction, ferric sulfate is dosed until a pH set point of 7.5 is reached. And this allows arsenic to precipitate out as ferrous arsenate. And then the polymer is added to the stream, which help to flocculate all the precipitated heavy metals contaminants, which are then removed by the geotube. Then the geotube filtrate is clean and free of heavy metals and TSS, making it ideal for discharge or, if needed, for further treatment by BioCord to remove soluble ammonia or BOD. This is an example about how, by just using a series of chemical dosing pumps, pH probes, pH controllers, and the flocculator, we are able to control a process to precipitate out hazardous material. If you are interested in what we have presented today about process control strategies on BioCord and solids management solution, or you want to learn more about the BioCord technology under for total nitrogen removal, and also to learn more about our research project, please do not hesitate to contact me or Christine. So that's almost it for the process control presentation. And before I end off and open the webinar to questions or comments, I just want to talk a bit about Bishop and who we are. What I'd like to highlight is our technology focus as a company. As we have grown over the past 20 years, we have dedicated a great deal of effort to develop technologies and systems that provide economic and environmental benefits to our clients and their communities. We do this by designing systems that they are reliable, easy to operate and maintain, have low energy requirements, and require little infrastructures around them. Of course, we couldn't do this without our great team, and we are very proud of the dedication that our team shows in working collaboratively with each other and our partners to continually improve the solutions that we offer. As we have seen, we have a number of different solutions that can be used separately or in tandem to address a whole array of wastewater treatment and solids management issues. I mentioned the Bishop Water Solids Management solution briefly before in this webinar. Those geotextile containers can be used not only for sludge and solids dewatering, but they can also be used for shoreline protection and prevention shoreline erosion, as well as in permanent process facility that require TSS removal or pretreatment. And then our BioCord reactors, of course, that are used for biological nutrient removal and enhanced cold weather treatment. We also offer a range of products that can help augment treatment or be integrated with our other solutions to allow for a turnkey or plug-and-play system that addresses more than one challenge at a time. For example, our chemical conditioning and polymer injection system that we have seen previously, and they are used in conjunction with our solid management solution to flocculate and help separate solids from a liquid stream. Then we have beneficial bacteria that can also be used to help with the bioaugmentation. These are essential blends of different types of wastewater treating bacteria that can be added to a system to help inoculate it or give it a bit of boost if you are struggling to maintain the population of a certain type of bacteria. And lastly, we also offer a rare earth coagulant for phosphorus removal called RE300. This is essentially a more effective, more versatile, and less hazard alternative to chemical coagulants such as alum or ferric that is used to precipitate out phosphorus. So RE300 can be used easily to help achieve real stringent phosphorus limits. And that's it for this webinar. If you are interested in BioCord for your application, please feel free to contact either Christine or myself, as well as if you want to receive updates or about more of our past and ongoing projects, don't forget to subscribe to our newsletter, which can be done by visiting the Bishop Water webpage. We will be sending out these slides as well as some literature to all the attendees today, including PDFs of our general BioCord brochure, as well as the brochure for our containerized system. We also have a technical results document, which includes some of the studies that we have presented in this webinar and in the past webinar. This document is available upon request if you are interested in using BioCord for potential projects and you want to see a summary of these results. So now I will answer any questions that have been collected from the dialogue box, if there are any. No, we don't have any questions, or we wait for 1 minute. It's some question that will show up. Okay, so as usual, if you have any questions, you can email those questions to me or Christine, and we were happy to answer them. And you can find you can email to this to email address, and or you can visit our Bishop Water website for any information. Thank you for joining us today. And we hope that you have enjoyed all this webinar series, and we look forward to hear from you, or we look forward to present more webinars in the future. Have a good rest of the day or evening to everybody.